So we're going to start what's called demand and supply analysis. And it really is where the story of micro kind of begins. We do demand and supply in both micro and macro, and we do it the same way. However, when you're talking about looking at small sectors of society, really, for me personally, this is where it kind of begins. What we're going to be using this to do, so demand and supply analysis will be used to establish what we call equilibrium prices and quantities within a market. So we want to establish what's called equilibrium prices and quantities within a market. We do this with demand and supply analysis. And later on, you'll see exactly what we mean by this concept of equilibrium. Now, a market in econ is very comprehensive and specific. So a market in econ, formally what we mean is a market is an institution or mechanism that brings together buyers and sellers for the purposes of exchange. So formally, what is a market? A market is an institution or mechanism that brings together buyers and sellers for the purposes of exchange. Any institution or mechanism where we have buyers and sellers meeting to exchange some goods, service, or resource, we consider that a market. So you go to the farmer's market, you give a seller $5 and they give you a bag of apples, face-to-face traditional market, we consider that in econ. In econ, we also consider non-traditional markets. It's not necessary for a face-to-face meeting for it to be a market.
Stock market.
So, stock market, for example, is a very good example. Amazon. All of us have Amazon, eBay. We've all bought stuff on eBay. You don't meet the people. Don't meet anybody on eBay, by the way. So you don't have to meet face-to-face, but you're still, our exchange is still being facilitated with this particular mechanism. We consider all of those when we're looking at markets in this context. So traditional markets where they meet face-to-face, or non-traditional markets where we have some sort of mechanism facilitating the exchange, but the buyer and seller is not necessary that they meet. All of that is what we consider when we talk about markets. Now very broadly and generally, markets are made up of buyers and sellers. We're going to look at the story that affects both of these players, one by one. And we're going to start off with the buyer. We're going to start off with demand. We're very familiar with that because we've all been demanders. So we'll start with that one. We're starting off with the buyer side, which is demand. This is from the perspective of the person buying the good. Now formally, demand shows the various amounts of a product. So demand shows the various amount of a product that consumers are willing and able to purchase at a particular price during a particular time. So, formally, this is what demand is. Demand shows the various amount of a product that consumers are willing and able to purchase at a particular price during a particular time. Now, firstly, to be counted in the demand, you have to be willing and able. Your desire for something does not translate into you demanding it. It's the willingness and the ability. Those are the people we're trying to capture. So earlier, I was talking to Daniel. I live in two places. I live in Woodland Hills and Long Beach. But for some reason, Monday night, I decided I was going to stay in Long Beach. Even though I had an 8 a.m. class here at Pierce. I don't know what's going on in my head. But Tuesday morning, you remember all of that rain? I left my house at 5:30 from Long Beach. And I got here at 7:59. So 5:30, 7:59. No, me personally, especially Tuesday morning, I am very willing to use a private jet as my mode of transportation. No, am I able? Absolutely not. I'm a teacher. There's no hidden wealth. I don't have any hidden land in Jamaica. Nothing like that. I'm not able. Should I be counted in the demand for private jets? The answer is no. We are looking at individuals who are willing and able. We have to capture both. In fact, let's do a little example. Let me give you a little example. Let's do a little example. Let's say we have some good, let's call it X. This is the price of X. And here is the quantity demanded of X. So, we look at the price of X. We're going to compare that with the quantity demanded of X. Let me give you some data. So that's 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 10, 20, 35, 55, and 80. When you look at the price of X and the quantity demanded of X, do you notice anything? So as the price goes down, the quantity demanded goes up. Down and up. What type of relationship is that?
Negative.
Negative relationship, which means the graph should look like what?
Down.
Very good. So people are ready for this quiz. Here's your quantity. Here's your price. This is your demand curve. Inverse relationship between price and the quantity demanded will mean the demand curve should be downward sloping. Everything is connected. There's no confusion. Price goes down, the quantity demanded goes up. It's a negative relationship. If we have a negative relationship, we should have a downward sloping curve. That's why we have our demand curve sloping downwards. And remember in econ, price-quantity relationship, you drop the quantity on the x-axis. Things get cheaper, people want more of it. That's what this is telling you. Things get more expensive, people want less of it. In fact, that relationship that you just described to me, it's so important in econ, it's an actual law. We call it the law of demand. The law of demand in a nutshell, I'm gonna do some econ in shorthand, you'll get used to it. What it says is, as the price of a good goes up, this leads to a drop in the quantity demanded. Law of demand, raise up the price, the quantity demanded will go down. Or you could flip it around, lower the price, this will lead to an increase in the quantity demanded.
So that have an inverse relationship?
Very good, that's why the demand curve is downward sloping. Look at the direction of the arrows. Up and down, down and up. That's the law of demand. An inverse relationship between price and quantity demanded. Lower the price, people want more of it. Raise up the price, people want less of it. I argue as an economist, the law of demand is never violated. I argue you raise up the price, you're gonna lose customers. You lower the price, you're gonna gain customers. And as an economist, I argue this is never violated.